In Isaiah 46, reading from verse number 9, the Bible tells us, remember the former things of old. For I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is no one, none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done. Saying, my counsel shall stand and I shall do my pleasure. This passage of scripture tells us a number of things about the nature and the character of the Almighty God and how he deals with the things that he speaks in our life. The first thing that you will notice is the fact that is the nature of the Almighty God is revealed. It said, remember the things of old, for I am God and there is none other. I am God and there is none other like me. Number two thing that you see in this passage is the passage tells us that God is not limited by time and space, which means that God sees the end from the very beginning. In verse number 10, it says, declaring the end from the very beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet, saying that my counsel shall stand. Number three, you'll find the passage tells us that God's purpose will always be established. God's purposes will always be established, which means God will do what he says he will do. Regardless of who, regardless of the situation and the circumstances, God's purposes will be established. He said, my counsel shall stand and I will do my pleasure. Now, because of this character of God and the nature of God that we see revealed in this verse of the scripture, it is therefore not very difficult for some people who understand this verse of scripture or understand the nature of God to understand that that God's promises sometimes takes a while to happen. The reason is because God is declaring the end from the very beginning. God is telling you what's about to happen. So when the Lord gives a promise, he's telling you what is about to happen in the future. And that is why when there is a gap, people who understand how God operates know that there is always a gap between the time the promise of God is given and when it is fulfilled. If you look through the Bible, you will notice that there is a pattern to the fulfillment of God's promises and God's prophetic agenda in the life of an individual, in the life of a nation, or in the life of any family. There is that particular pattern. And for those who have taken the time to look, you will notice that God, when God makes a promise, it does not, sometimes it appears that the promise is not fulfilled. Sometimes it appears as if things are delayed. You will even notice that things may not appear to be happening. You have even, the devil sometimes might appear as if he's on the loose and he's just doing whatever he likes and God has forgotten about what he has said concerning us. Okay? Things might even look worse even after we have received the promise. All these, and then all of a sudden God begins to put things together. All of a sudden the pieces begin to come together. Before you know what's happening, you wake up one morning and the promise that appeared to have been forgotten, the promise that the enemy seems to have overtaken, that promise all of a sudden begins to be fulfilled. And many begin to wonder, why did God take so long to respond, to fulfill his promise? Did he change his mind along the way and then probably look at the way I behaved and say, okay, this guy doesn't deserve the blessings anymore? What was God waiting for before he answered my prayers? These and many more questions go through the heart of many people, especially when they are going through difficult times. But what we often forget is that while we are waiting for the promise of the Almighty God, and when it appears as if nothing is happening, God is still busy walking behind the scenes. When everything appears as if life is silent, as if the enemy has taken over, as if God has forgotten, I want you to be comforted by the fact that God is putting the pieces together for the fulfillment of his promises in our life. When life looks so bleak, when all hope seems to have been lost, when the devil seems to be the one in charge, I want you to know that God is working to bring you to the place of his promise. How do I know this? I know this because of what the Bible tells us. The confidence of what the Bible tells us in the Word of God. The Bible tells us that God is not a man that he should lie, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. Has he said it, and shall he not do it? Or has he spoken, and shall he not make it good? In other words, whatever the Lord God Almighty declares, no matter how long it takes, no matter how vicious the enemy might become, the promises of the Almighty God will always come to pass. And I'm confident and I know this to be a fact because of what the Bible tells us in 2 Peter chapter 3. If you read in verse number 9, it said, the Lord is not slack concerning his promises. In other words, when he gives his promises, he doesn't just forget about it. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards what? not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. In other words, the Lord God Almighty, when He gives His promise, He is mindful of what He has said. He is mindful to fulfill what He has said He will do. He is always keeping it in front of Him, and He will bring it to pass regardless of what the enemy is doing. Which means, if you take a look at the promise of the Almighty God, you'll find out that no matter how long it takes, it will always come to pass. I mean, take a look at the promise of the Messiah. God made the promise immediately after the fall. In Genesis chapter 3, reading from verse 15, the Bible says, I will put an enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and he shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heels. This was the promise of the Messiah. This was the promise of the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. After 26 generations, approximately 4,000 years, Moses repeated the promise. In the book of Deuteronomy chapter 18, if you read from verse 15, Moses said, the Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee and of thy brethren like unto me. Unto him ye shall hearken. Isaiah repeated the same prophecy again. The same promise was repeated in Isaiah chapter 7. If you read from verse number 14, the Bible tells us, it says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. All through the scriptures, you see every prophet of the Almighty God giving more information about the coming of the Savior. And for centuries, this promise that has been from the very beginning, for centuries, everything went silent. The people of God waited for this promised Messiah. And while they waited, God was walking behind the scene. As the people longed for the fulfillment of this particular prophecy, the Lord God Almighty was setting the stage to go for the great reveal. And as the time came, the Bible makes us to understand that unrelated event that appeared to be unrelated, people that appeared not to have any connection with one another, things started happening. Different characters started showing up as the Lord set the stage for the coming of His dear Son. The promise that appeared to have been forgotten, that promise that appeared to have been lost, the age-long prophecy was suddenly fulfilled, and thereby reminding us that when the heavens are quiet, when the heavens appear silent, when God appears to have forgotten what He said to you, God is still walking behind the scene. When nothing seemed to be happening, when the enemy seemed to be the one that is having the upper hand, when things appear to be going sideways, God is most busy pulling the pieces together and working all things for our own good. Why is this very important? It is very important that we understand this particular process, that there is a waiting period, a gap between the time the Lord speaks and when that particular action happens. There is a gap between the time He gives a promise and when that promise is fulfilled. It is very important that we understand this, especially in this particular season that we are going through. In the season when the whole world is experiencing what is called the lockdown. In the season when the promises that we received at the beginning of the year appear to have evaporated. It is important for us to remember that God is still busy walking behind the scene, especially in this season when the hope of many is failing. When the hope of many appears to have been dead. When many have lost their job. Many have lost their loved one. Many are fearful to even get out of their own houses. And they begin to wonder, Lord, what you told me at the beginning of the year, how is it going to be fulfilled in this particular condition? Let us be reminded that God is always walking, even behind the scenes. In our waiting season, the Lord is still very much active. The Bible says that God is not slack concerning His promise, but He is faithful to keeping them and bringing them to pass. And that is why throughout this month that is ending today, we spent a lot of time looking at how we can survive the waiting season. In our first installment, we looked at the life of Joseph, a man who received a prophetic vision of his future. We saw his dream. We saw his betrayal. We saw his suffering in Egypt. And we asked the question, how did Joseph survive the season that he had to wait before he saw the fulfillment of the promise? And we said that Joseph survived his waiting season in the house of Potiphar, in the jailhouse of Egypt. We said he survived by waiting, by engaging in the season of waiting. In other words, he was not just sitting idle. was engaged in his talent, engaged in his wisdom, being very faithful to the work that he has been called, knowing that he is going somewhere. In our second installment, we looked at the life of Sarah, the woman behind the friend of God. We looked at her life. We looked at her faith. We looked at her challenges and the frustration that she faced as she waited for the promised child. And we asked the same question. How did Sarah survive her waiting season? And we said, Sarah survived her waiting season. Sarah survived that waiting season by first of all realizing that a very bad attitude will not help you. Because initially she went through her waiting season with a very bad attitude, wanting to manipulate the situation, wanting to play God. And then eventually she realized that because of that bad attitude, she had created a lot of problems for herself, a problem for her family, and problem for even that promised child that God has promised her. But then she finally realized that for you to make the best of the season that God has put you in, for you to make the best of the time that you are waiting for the fulfillment of the promise of God, your attitude needs to be adjusted. And only our attitude during our season of waiting has a consequential effect on life after the promise has come. And so we looked at the life of Sarah, and we found that your attitude matters when you are waiting for the promise of the Almighty God. Number three, in our third installment, we looked at the life of David. Here was a man who did the nation a favor. Here was a man that fought Goliath and defeated and removed the reproach out of Israel. King Saul now decided to make him an enemy, pursued him with all the resources of the kingdom, and David kept on running from one place to the other. And we ask the same question again. How did David survive the long road to the promised throne that the Lord has given unto him? We said David survived while waiting for the season by investing in himself, by investing in the people that came unto him, he came in contact with him, and by investing in his relationship with the Almighty God. And that's why if you read the book of Psalms, you will see all the time that David was running up and down. He was busy cataloging his relationship with the Almighty God. He was busy blessing the people that came into him, investing in them and developing himself. Eventually, David became a mighty man. And it was recorded in scripture that David had mighty men, which was not recorded for any other king. The point we are making is that David survived his waiting season by investing himself and investing in the relationships that he had. And in our fourth installment last week, we talked about the life of Elisha, a successful businessman, a man that had 12 yokes of oxen, the man that had a lucrative business. We saw how he abandoned and cut the ties to his old life. We saw how this successful man became the servant of a wandering prophet who even have no home. We asked the same question again. How did Elisha survive his own season of waiting? We said that Elisha survived the season of waiting by leveraging the experiences that God has brought him to. Elisha understood that life is a series of experiences. Elisha understood that the earlier you recognize the experiences, the contribution of those experiences in your life, the earlier you begin to see how those experiences will lead you to the place that God is taking you, the sooner you begin to enjoy the blessings of God in your life. And so this morning, as we close out this particular series, we want to look at a group of individuals, how they were able to survive the waiting period, how they received the experience that not only changed their life, but changed the world that they lived in at that point in time. I'm talking about the disciples of our Lord Jesus Christ. We want to look at how they waited and received the power of the Holy Spirit, how they received the promise of the Father on the day of Pentecost. We want to see how they were able to endure the silence of heaven in the period when they were waiting. And that's where we're going to be looking at the book of Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, reading from verse number 1, the Bible says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Then suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. From this verse of the scripture, I want you to know, there's a number of things that I want you to notice here. The first thing is that this verse of scripture tells us that God's promises are fulfilled at an appointed time. You cannot rush the promise of the Almighty God. My mother used to say something that as small as the face of the watch is, it takes 24 hours for the hands to go around. No matter how much you are in a hurry, You will have to wait an extra 12 or almost 12 hours before you can see June 1, 2020. The point we are making is that God's promises are fulfilled at an appointed time. The Bible says when the day of Pentecost was fully come. In other words, any other thing that came before that day was not Pentecost. Any other thing that appeared before that time was not Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, depending on the power of God was released, the promise of God will always be fulfilled at the appointed time. Number two thing that we see from the verse of the scripture is that God's promises are fulfilled when we are in one accord with Him and with one another. The Bible tells us when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. In other words, there has to be an agreement with the Almighty God. There has to be an agreement in spirit with God, an agreement in spirit with our fellow men, before we can begin to see the manifestation of the glory of God in our life. The day of Pentecost, the promise of God will not be fulfilled at our own timing. It is fulfilled at the timing, at the appointed time of the Almighty God. The promise of the Almighty God is fulfilled when we are in agreement with Him. Number three, the promise of the Almighty God is fulfilled in a manner of God's choosing. In other words, God decides how He wants to fulfill His promises. Okay? You might pray and say, God, I expect to see X, Y, and Z. And God say, well, you're looking that direction, this is the direction that I'm going. God fulfills His promises in His own, in a manner of His own choosing. It is His promise, and He will do it the way He wants to do it. The Bible says, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. When the Holy Ghost will come, you will expect it to come in a different way. Maybe it should zap them, so that they can just have all their hair standing up. But the Lord said, no, I'm going to come in a mighty rushing way. The same thing happened to Elijah. Elijah was expecting the Almighty God to come in an earthquake, but the Bible said the Lord was not there. Elijah expected a wild wind to bring the presence of the Almighty God, but God was not there. But God showed up to Elijah in a still small voice. To the apostles, when the day of Pentecost was ready, the Lord came as a mighty rushing wind. In other words, that tells us God fulfills His promises in the manner of His own choosing. He determines how He wants to do what He has promised to do in your life. And the question there is, why is this understand? Why is this important for us to understand? Why am I emphasizing this? I am emphasizing this because knowing how God fulfills His promise does a number of things for you. The first thing is this: when you know how God answers His prayer, when you know that God has the omnipotent authority, when you know He has the privilege and He has the prayer, the ability to determine when and how He wants to answer your prayer, it frees you from all fears and anxiety. Because you know He's the one in charge. He's the one who's going to do it. Whether you can fret from now till tomorrow, it doesn't change it. God will do it when He's supposed to do it. So when you understand that, it frees you from worry and anxiety. When you understand that, you learn how to wait patiently before the Almighty God. When you understand that, the devil will not be able to cheat you anymore, because he will not be able to give you a gimmick and tell you stories that are not true, because you already understand how God operates. It frees you. And then finally, it gives you the grace to be able to trust and to rest on His faithfulness, because you know He will do it. You may not know the time. You may not know how, you may not know when, but you know that He will do it. That gives you the grace and the ability to be able to rest and to trust in His faithfulness. And this was what the disciples understood. The disciples have gone with the Lord Jesus Christ for 3 years. They have been with Him in the rough seas. They have been with Him when there was no money. They have been with Him in different circumstances and situations. And they knew that the Lord will always come at the time He has promised. At the right time, He will show. The disciples understood this process, so they did not worry. Because they knew how God operated, they were waiting patiently. Because they understood that God will never disappoint, they were resting in His faithfulness that He will come through. And now please understand. It is one thing for you to know how God operates. It's another thing for you to go through the process of His operation. It is one thing to know that, yes, God will do it when He will do it. But it's a different thing when you open the fridge and there's no food. You go to the pantry, there is nothing there. You look at the bank account, there is nothing there. How, at that point in time, will you believe that God will do it when He said He will do it? It is a different story. It's one thing for you to know something. It's another thing for you to experience it. It's one thing for you to be able to understand the words of Scripture. It's another thing for you to experience the process of the Scripture. And so the question this morning is, how did the disciples, knowing how God will do, knowing how God operates, how did they survive the period that the heavens were silent? How did the disciples go through the period when heaven was not giving them any instruction? When there were no indication that God was going to do anything? When there were no indication that the Holy Spirit would pour upon them? How did the disciples survive their own waiting season? Now, for you to understand how the disciples survive their own waiting season, we must first of all look at the road that led them to the fulfillment of the promise. In other words, how did they get to the point where they enjoyed the promise? How did they get to the experience? How did they get to, what was the road that led to the experience of Pentecost for this group of individuals? We must look at how they got there if we are going to see. Because the secret of their survival, the secret of their waiting, the secret of their being able to receive the promise lies in how they got to that particular experience in the first place. The secret of how they became the recipient of the Holy Spirit is a function of how they themselves got to the point where they were able to receive the promise of the Spirit in the first place. So the real question this morning is not really how they survived, but how did they get to the place of experiencing the Holy Ghost and the Pentecost in the first place. Let's go back to the book of Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, reading from verse number 4, the Bible tells us, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know times or season which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost, when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses, you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea, in Samaria, and to the end of the earth. Now, from this verse of the scripture, you will see that the road that the disciples traveled to Pentecost, the road that led to Pentecost for the disciples, started with a gathering. It started with the coming to the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible said, being gathered together with them, when the Lord Jesus Christ brought them together, when they came in contact with the Almighty God, they positioned themselves for the experience of Pentecost. In other words, you cannot expect God to do anything in your life. You cannot expect the promise of God to be fulfilled in your life when you are not ready to meet with the Almighty God, when you are not ready to come to Him, when you are not ready to submit to Him. The experience of Pentecost is impossible without first coming to the Savior. The experience of Pentecost is impossible if you are not ready to walk with the Lord. The disciples had to first of all come to Jesus. They had to walk with Jesus. They had to allow Jesus to transform them before they can experience the promise of the Father. And the same thing in our own life. If the promise of God is going to be fulfilled in your life, for you to even be able to wait for that promise, you have to first of all have an encounter with the promise giver. So there will be no Pentecost without first an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is how the disciples first of all got to the point. That was how they positioned themselves for Pentecost. Number two, how did the disciples get to the Pentecost? How did they position themselves for Pentecost? They positioned themselves for Pentecost by traveling the road that is paved with obedience and command. Obedience to the command and instruction of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says that, and being assembled together, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise. You cannot experience the fulfillment of the promise of God without a willingness to obey his instruction. You cannot experience the blessings of heaven if you are not willing to follow his command. The Bible says that the experience of Pentecost for the disciples happened because they had to obey what the Lord Jesus Christ told them. The experience of Pentecost is impossible for the disciples unless they first listened to what Jesus said and obeyed his instruction and followed his command. If you're not willing to do that, then forget about the answer to prayer. God will not continue. The Bible said that we cannot continue to live in sin. In other words, you cannot continue to live in rebellion against the Almighty God and expect his grace to continue to multiply in your life. It's not going to happen. You don't do it. You don't expect God to do it.
Somebody that can, you know, that's why the banks will refuse to lend some people money. That's why we have credits. You cannot continue to refuse to pay your bill and then expect the bank to keep giving you money. The bank is not, they are in the business of making money. God will not continue to shower his blessings upon you, fulfill his promise upon you when you live in total opposition and rebellion against him. The road to Pentecost for the disciples passed through the road of obedience and the road of following the instruction of the Almighty God. And the same thing for us if we are going to see the blessings of the Almighty God manifest in our life as we wait for his promises. We must be willing to travel the road of obedience and the road of following, the road that follows the command of the Almighty God. There are those who want to enjoy Pentecost but without following the instruction and the command of the Almighty God. And that is an illusion. There is this thing that goes on in church that says, yeah, all you have to do is just bring your tithe and bring your offering and God will bless you for that. I tell you one thing. The church will take your money, but you are not going to get any blessing. I can assure you. If you live a life of disobedience, outright disobedience to the Almighty God, your tithe and your offering that you are bringing to church is a waste of time. It is useless. Pastors will take it. We will take it because we have better things for it, but it will not bless you. The Bible says you first of all give your heart to the Almighty God, willing to obey him. When you surrender yourself unto him, whatever you now bring to the altar becomes acceptable. We must, as a church, begin to do what we know is right. Pentecost is impossible if you are not willing to follow his commands. Number three, the road to Pentecost is illuminated by the promises of the Almighty God. These people were able to travel the journey because there was a promise that was attached onto it. There's discouragement as you move along the way. There is going to be frustration. The enemy will continue to remind you of the things that, you know, of the things that are not happening in your life. But when you remember the promise of the Almighty God, when you remember that, yes, the Almighty God has said this is what he's going to do, it helps you continue to travel the journey. The Bible says in verse number 5, it says, but John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. In verse number 8, he said, but you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. In other words, they were able to travel the journey because they know something is waiting at the end of the journey, at the end of the road. The same thing. The promise of God becomes life when you believe and you know that, yes, there's a promise that is waiting for you. There's a fulfillment of that promise. But if you don't believe the word of God, if you have not received any promise, why will you wait? Why will you travel the journey? Okay, the experience of Pentecost is impossible without first receiving and believing the promise of the Holy Ghost. It is not possible for you to experience Pentecost without first believing in the promise of Pentecost. There are those who want to enjoy the power of Pentecost, but they do not believe in the reality of Pentecost. And that's what we talked about during the time of our life plan. When our brother was explaining and telling us that, yes, there are a lot of controversies in the church. There are people who believe that the Pentecost is over. There are people who do not even believe in the power of the Holy Ghost. But yes, they want to see miracles. How do you think miracles happen? Miracles do not happen outside of the Holy Ghost, because the Holy Ghost is the power of God that brings the things of God to fulfillment in our life. So if you want to experience Pentecost, you must first of all believe in the promise of Pentecost. Number 4, the road to Pentecost requires a return to the appointed place. The road to Pentecost requires a return to the appointed place. Look at verse number 12 of Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. The Bible says, and they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. You remember Jesus Christ said that, do not leave Jerusalem. He said, remain there until you receive the power. That at that time, they were not yet in Jerusalem. But for them to be able to enjoy the promise that God has given unto them, they had to return to that appointed place. There is an appointed place for everything that God has spoken concerning your life. There's an appointed time for everything that he has said is going to do in your life. You must be at the right place at the time when the Lord God Almighty said you should be there. When Elijah was running away from Jezebel and Ahab, the Bible says that he was wandering the wilderness. And the Lord God Almighty met him when he was tired and he was suicidal. The Lord now asked him the question. He said, Elijah, what are you doing here? In other words, this is not the appointed place for you. This is not the place that I want you to be. When Jesus Christ resurrected and he spoke to the disciples, he said, go and tell my brethren to meet me at a particular place. There is a place that is appointed. In this day and age, the place that the Lord has appointed for you is at the prayer altar. That is where the Lord visits his people. That is where the Lord gives revelation to his people. That's where the Lord God Almighty transformed the life of an individual. You cannot experience Pentecost. You cannot experience the power of God if you are not willing to go to the appointed place.
And the disciples understood this. They understood that Pentecost will not happen in their life unless they return to the appointed place. Number five, it is not just going to the appointed place. They understood that Pentecost happens when you go to the appointed place and you spend quality time in the upper room. Look at verse number 13. The Bible says, when they had entered, in other words, when they got to the appointed place, they went up into the upper room when they were staying. Peter, James, and all the other disciples. Verse number 14. They were all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. In other words, it is not enough for you to be in an appointed place. You must spend quality time in the upper room. You must spend quality time on that particular prayer altar. You must be able to touch the hem of his garment from your prayer altar. The experience of Pentecost cannot happen without you visiting and spending a quality time in the upper room. It is not enough for you to put one hand in the pocket and just walk around and say, God, God bless me. I mean, you can do that, but you're not going to get anything, you know, because God is not your body. God is God. The idea you must understand is that there has to be a quality time spent at the prayer altar, spent in the upper room, for you to experience the power and the blessings of Pentecost. Number six, the road to Pentecost requires a reorganization, a reordering of your body, a reordering of your priorities. Bible tells us in verse number 21, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verse 21. It says, therefore, of the men who have accompanied us all the time that the Lord went in and out amongst us, beginning from the baptism of John to that day when he was taken up from us, one of these men must be witnesses with us to his resurrection. In other words, they knew that there was a particular body. They had to reorganize themselves in order to be able to be a good representation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Business as usual was not enough. For you to experience Pentecost in your life, for you to see the hand of God move on your behalf, for you to see the fulfillment of the promise of God, there has to be some reorganization in your life. The Bible says we cannot continue to live in sin and expect the grace of God to continue. You cannot continue to do what you used to do in the past and expect that God will continue to release his grace upon you. You can't continue to live anyhow and expect that the secrets of heaven will be given unto you. You cannot continue to live a life that does not glorify the name of the Almighty God and expect that the power of God, the grace of God, will be abundant in your life. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. So there must be a visit to the upper room. But beyond that, there has to be a reorganization in your life, a reordering of your life, a reprioritization of your life. You have to be able to put the first thing first. If you are serious about getting the experience that is promised unto you, something must give. Something must change. A student that is busy partying and wants to get an A is either in La La Land or he wants to go and buy the question paper somewhere. Because if you are willing to really study and get the results that you desire, the party has to go, or you forget about the A. The same thing is an employee who wants to get the promotion at work. You don't show up like that the company belongs to you. Even if the company belongs to you, it will not take long before it becomes bankrupt. If you show up anytime, there has to be discipline. There has to be a reorganization of your, a reordering of your life. There has to be putting things in proper perspective. Priority must take place. You have to put first thing first. The same thing with the Almighty God. You cannot experience the hand of God, the move of God, the power of God, if you don't want to change anything. You want to continue to eat your cake and have it, it's not going to be possible. The Bible makes us to understand that God himself expects that there should be a change in your life. These people had to change the way they did things. They had to change their organization for them to be able to experience the power of Pentecost. And then finally, the road to Pentecost for the disciples required continued fellowship. It required continued fellowship. The Bible says when the day of Pentecost fully came, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. The experience of Pentecost cannot happen, and it cannot be sustained, and it cannot be expanded. It cannot be poured, you know, it cannot be made to fill the whole world if we do not remain in fellowship with God and in fellowship with one another. If you do not continue in fellowship, the experience of Pentecost will be an illusion in your life. If you do not continue in fellowship, the fulfillment of the promise of God will be an illusion in your life. The point we are making is that fellowship, continuing in fellowship, is required for us to continue to enjoy the abundant grace, for us to be continually connected to the power source. There are many who feel that because, yes, we are all now on lockdown, this is a good example for them not to come to church anymore. We are going to be opening church on Friday. It is better for you to be there. Because that is where you begin to fellowship with one another. That is where our iron sharpens iron. That is where you begin to understand what it means to be in the body of Christ. I used to joke and I tell people, why do you say God said that you have patience? It's because we are going to have people like me that you are going to be patient with. Because if you don't have someone like me that is that will make life interesting for you, what will be the need for you to have patience? You know, if you don't have people like me, you don't need patience. The point you are making is that we grow in the faith when we are in fellowship. We exercise the gift of the Spirit when we are in fellowship. We advance the cause of Christ when we are in fellowship. But when you stay on your own, it makes it very difficult for you to grow. And you become a prime target for the enemy. And the power of Pentecost is useless when you are not connected with anybody. The Bible said that you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost come upon me, and you will be my witnesses. In other words, the power is given for a particular reason. God releases his grace upon your life for a particular reason. And the reason is so that you can impact the life of other people. If you refuse to go into fellowship, then what is the essence of you getting the Spirit? And that's why many pray and don't get the baptism of the Spirit. The reason is because God does not want to give. The reason is because they don't want to use it for anything. Many of us also want to show that, yes, we are super Christian. We can shabla, shabla, shabla up till now the kingdom come. That is the purpose why some people want it. And God knows the heart of every individual. And if that is the reason why you are seeking the baptism, you can forget about it because it's not going to give you. You remember when Jesus Christ went to the presence, went to the presence of Herod. Herod said he wanted to see some miracles. And Jesus said, today, I'm not a magician. I'm not a showman. I'm not giving you anything. And that was the only person that Jesus Christ met and never said a word to. Because the intention of the guy, he wanted a show. And God is not in the business of making shows. Okay? So the point we are making here this morning is that if you want to experience the fulfillment of the promise of God for your life, there has to be a continuation in fellowship. There has to be a remaining in fellowship. There has to be a continued connection, not only with your fellow man, but with the Almighty God. Because when the connection is broken, fellowship breaks down. And as fellowship breaks down, there is no need, there's no life wire that brings you the source of life into the life of an individual. So you see, the disciples got the Pentecost experience by coming to Christ and believing his promise. They got the Pentecost experience by obeying his command and following his instruction. They got the Pentecost experience by returning and staying in the appointed place. They got the Pentecost experience by not only that, but spending quality time in the upper room. They got the Pentecost experience by reordering their life and remaining in fellowship. That is how they got to the place of promise. But if you read the Bible carefully, it took them 40 days for that particular Pentecost experience to come. It took them 40 days for God to pour down his power upon them. And the question is, what were they doing? What were they doing within that 40 days? What were they doing? How did they survive their waiting period? Number one, they survived their waiting period because they envisioned a possible future. They envisioned a possible future. If you look at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verse 6, the Bible says that therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, in other words, they asked Jesus, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? In other words, right up to the time that Jesus Christ was taken from their midst, there's only one question that these people kept asking. They were asking when Jesus was going to restore the kingdom, because they believed that when the Messiah came, he was going to restore the kingdom of Israel. But they did not know that he was talking about the restoration of the spiritual kingdom. The point we are making is that it is important. They were able to survive that particular period of waiting because they had a picture of a future that they were expecting. There was a vision of a possible future that they know will come when the power came upon them. That was one of the things. You cannot wait for the promise of God if you cannot see what the promise of God will look like in your life. You cannot wait. You cannot wait for the promise of God if you cannot envision yourself in that particular promise. The disciples were able to wait, you know, survive their waiting season, by envisioning a possible future. Number two, they were able to survive their waiting season, but by true simple obedience. They believed God and they obeyed his word. The Bible says that being assembled together, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father. The Bible makes us to understand because they believed and they obeyed, they were able to survive that period. As they waited there, they said, the Lord said we should wait, we are waiting. There might be distraction that might be coming, but the Lord said we should wait. There might be enemy that might be whispering in my ears, but the Lord said you should wait. But there might be things that might not be going the way that I expected to go, and I want to see the result faster than I expect, but the Lord says wait. And they waited. That was how they survived. They obeyed the commandment of the Almighty God. Number three, they survived by spending time in the upper room. They were not idle. They were not just going up and down. They were not sitting down just fiddling or just fiddling with things. They were busy in the upper room. They spent time in the upper room. By praying, they were waiting on him. By supplication, they were waiting on him. By seeking the face of the Almighty God, they were waiting on the Almighty God. That was how they survived. You cannot survive if you just sit down there and say, well, Jesus said we should wait, we're waiting. We don't even know when he's going to come now. Eh? He said he was going to restore the kingdom. Now we have come, he has died, he has not restored the kingdom. I don't even know what he's going to do, what he says he's going to do. I mean, if you sit down and that is what is going through your mind, you will not be able to survive. And that is what a lot of people do. We pray, we receive the promise of God, say he's going to heal, he's going to deliver, he's going to provide. And then you sit down, the thing did not happen tomorrow. And then I don't even know what all these people are saying. All these pastors, they make all these promises. They tell us the Bible says X, Y, and Z, but nothing is happening. I don't even know, Joe. Maybe we should even think about this. Heaven help those who help themselves. You know that is not written in the scripture, but that's a story for another day. The point we are making is that people begin to allow themselves to do a lot of funky things because they are not spending time in the upper room. The way you survive your waiting season, the way the disciples survive their waiting season, is to spend time in the upper room. And not only that, is to continue in fellowship. There is an adage that says that the dog that is going to be lost will never hear the voice of what? Will never hear the voice of the hunter. Which means that when you are separated from the pack, it's easy to get lost. When the enemy is about to punish an individual, the first thing he does to that person is to separate that person from fellowship. Because it is easy to deal with an individual than to deal with a bunch of people. And normally you know there are times when you get tired. And you come into fellowship. And you come into the midst of a fellow believer. All of a sudden, there's a strength that comes from above. That is the strength that you get in fellowship. And that is why the Lord says, remain and continue in fellowship. Because that's the only way you can survive. If you isolate yourself, if you put yourself aside, if you do not connect with other people, you will begin to find out that the fire upon your altar will start burning low. And as it starts burning low, the enemy has an inroad. And then the enemy might be able to strike that person down. And that is why the people, the disciples understood this. And the way they waited when heaven was not talking, the way they waited when they were not seeing the manifestation of the promise of God, was to continue in fellowship with one another. Because the Bible says, iron sharpens iron. It says, two are better than one. Because when one falls, the other one will lift him up. When one begins to get discouraged, the other person can begin to speak. When one begins to lose sight, the other one can begin to refocus that individual. We must, for us to be able to survive our own days of challenge, for us to be able to survive our own season of waiting, we must remain and continue in fellowship. And that's why we encourage one another to call one another, to be able to pray for one another, to be able to visit one another, so that you can continue in fellowship and strengthen one another. Most importantly, number five, they survived their waiting season by not having another plan, by not having an escape plan, by not having plan B. They had no option. Matthew chapter 19, verse 27, the Bible tells us there of an encounter between Peter and the Lord Jesus Christ when he was still alive. Peter asked the question. He said, behold, we have forsaken all and followed thee. What shall we have? In other words, this is the only plan that I have, Master. This is the only thing that is going on for me. Oh boy, tell me that I'm putting my money in the right place, that I'm budgeting the right thing, I'm staking it on the right thing. If there is no, you know, if there is no benefit to this thing, then just let me know. And the Lord Jesus Christ told him specifically, say, those who have given up everything, they will receive what? They will receive a hundredfold. In other words, they survived their waiting season by, you know, by putting everything on the altar. They survived everything by putting everything on the table and saying, Lord, we don't have any option. Lord, we don't have any other, you know, we don't have any other alternative. We are willing to continue to stake the whole thing. That's how they survive. If you, as long as you have options, there is a tendency for you not to wait. As long as you have options, there's a tendency for you to look for other avenue. But as soon as you know that this is your only way, just like David, Jacob said to David, said to the Almighty God, when he was running, you know, when he was about to meet Esau, he said, oh Lord, and I will not let you go unless you bless me. In other words, I don't have any other option. If that is the way, if that is your attitude, you'll find that waiting becomes easy. Because that is the only option you have. And we all know the story. They survived the waiting season. They got the promise and the rest is history. They were able to turn the whole world around. The beauty of this is that if we are able to, you know, to survive our own waiting season, if we are able to be like the disciples and to remain in his presence and to spend time in the upper room and to remain in fellowship and then have no other plan, we too will enjoy the benefit of what they enjoy. Number one, we are going to enjoy the benefit of fulfilled promises. Number two, we're going to enjoy the outpouring of the power of God. Number three, we're going to see, we're going to become the change agent because the power of God will fill us to overflowing and will become agents of change. And just like I said before, surviving the waiting season is not the exclusive preserve of just one or two disciples, of one or two super Christians. No. It is the privilege of every child of God. And the question is that, are you that kind of a child of God? Are you that particular kind of individual who is determined to survive their own waiting season?